What's the first thing that comes to mind when you think of sickle cell?
The first thing that comes to mind is pain. As a sickle cell patient, pain is almost kind of guaranteed. It's like the one thing you're guaranteed. I mean, there are various different types of crises, but painful crisis is the one that I experience the most, and I think other sickle patients experience the most. It's annoying because it can happen anywhere, and you can be out. I've been in situations where I've been in a club or I've been out shopping and it just happens. There's nothing I can do to stop it.
We go through so much pain within our lives, from the day we're born to, I guess, the day we die, really. It's something that's unavoidable, and it's a massive part of our life, and I feel like we're constantly striving to eliminate the pain from our life. That's why I chose pain to represent sickle cell.
So much lack of awareness when it comes to sickle cell. And there's, like, we're in 2017 now, and the fact that we haven't even moved forward in regards to knowing about sickle cell, knowing how it's passed on, the possibilities of it being passed on, and a different type of sickle cell, it kind of makes me, I don't know, I'm on the verge of being angry at the fact that there's not much awareness about sickle cell, especially within the African and Caribbean communities.
There is no warning sign that your body gives you that you're about to go into crisis, so you could just be going about your normal day and it happens, and the pain is, I can't really articulate it. The pain, the type of pain it is it's as if somebody is inside your bone with a knife, stabbing you from the inside out. So they're inside the bone with the knife, stabbing like this, and that pain is what's radiating out and it spreads.
And I feel like there could be a lot more awareness. I always watch charity shows in the UK, things like Children in Need, Comet Relief. I feel like they never ever highlight sickle cell. I've personally never seen sicklers on those types of charity shows.
It's a simple thing where it just takes, you know, 5 minutes just to read up or even to actually ask the question, you know, to inform people about it. And it's a thing where it's holding, I don't know, it's holding people back when it comes to actually talking about it themselves, because if a man isn't going to talk to someone about sickle cell, and then they're going to have a preconceived idea of what it is based on them not knowing what sickle cell is, it's kind of off-putting. And I feel as if this just stems from the whole Africa situation where sickle cell is actually seen in a negative light.
Definitely within the African community, there is a stigma attached to sickle cell that it's a, in a sense, a death sentence. It's not. I have sickle cell, my hemoglobin type is SS. I work 9 to 5, I'm also studying for my master's. I go to the gym, I go out with my friends. I have a normal, relatively normal life. I mean, there are things I need to put in place to ensure I can have that normal life, but I'm able to live a normal life. So it's not a death sentence. When I was born, I think the life expectancy of children with sickle cell at that time was 10 years old. I'm now 27. So science moves, medicine moves, and as a result of that, I'm not limited as to how I can live my life. So when you encounter people with sickle cell, don't think, oh, just because they've got sickle cell, they can't live, or they're gonna die soon, or it's a death sentence, or they're weak or vulnerable. I mean, there are weaknesses and vulnerabilities, but they're not weak, they're not vulnerable. We're strong. We're probably the strongest set of people that you'll ever encounter. We have to live a normal life with an invisible disability. So we're very strong as a group of people. Don't write us off. We are still human. We're just like you. Everything you can do, I can do. Everything you can do, we can do. So don't write us off.
and it's full of stigma. Like, you know, if a child has sickle cell, like in my case, I think my parents didn't really tell me much about sickle cell because they was afraid that it would hold me back. And it didn't prepare me for life with the condition because I didn't know that I had the condition myself, and that's due to lack of awareness. And even though my dad has sickle cell himself, he didn't, you know, feel it was necessary for him to tell me about sickle cell. So imagine me, you know, living my life, you know, in my mid-20s, I'm having a sickle cell crisis episode. You know, I could have died. And I'm going to the medical center, and that's my first experience of knowing that I had sickle cell disease. It's kind of, it was a lot to take because I wasn't diagnosed that I had sickle cell. I was told that I had cancer. So imagine going to the medical center, you know, in crippling pain, and then a medical doctor telling me that I have cancer. So it was a lot to take because I was in university doing my first degree at the time, and finding out that I had, you know, cancer, it was devastating. So I thought as if I was going to die. And then a week later, they told me to come back. They said, well, it's not cancer, it's sickle cell. It's similar, but it's sickle cell disease. So my head is all over the place. I'm thinking, what is sickle cell? Is that worse than cancer? Is that better than cancer? What is going on? So I went back home, I researched the condition, and I came back and I just started asking questions to the doctor. I'm like, what type of sickle cell do I have? You know, what is my blood levels? And he just didn't know what to tell me. I'm like, what kind of sickle cell? He's like, well, you have sickle cell disease. I'm like, but there's different types of sickle cell. What type do I have? And he's like, you've got sickle cell. And I'm like, it takes me 1 week of actually finding out the research for myself to know more than the doctor. How does that work?
I've been admitted into hospitals in the north of England where doctors have never ever met a sickler in their life. They don't know how to treat us. They don't know how to respond to us. And it's pretty shocking and it's pretty mind-blowing because they won't transfer you to your local hospital due to cost and funds. So they would rather treat you in their hospital, not knowing what they're doing to you. So I've had some pretty terrible experiences in different hospitals around the world, and I would say that London is, I'm pretty restricted as to where I can live in the world. London is the best place, probably the only place for me.
People's knowledge of sickle cell is lacking. I think the knowledge is lacking. People are unaware of the condition. They're unaware of the implications of the condition. They're unaware of how it affects day-to-day life of a sickle patient. So I kind of put people into groups. There are groups of people who don't know about sickle cell, period. Probably never heard of it, never had to come into, never had any encounters with anybody with sickle cell.
The second issue, or the second stigma that I have, I personally have not experienced this, but I have heard it go on amongst the sickle cell community, and a couple of my friends have experienced this, is that some doctors and nurses feel that sicklers sometimes pull it on, or sicklers sometimes go into hospital or, you know, accident and emergency just because they're addicted to painkillers, pain relief. Now, this is a big stigma across the sickle cell community. Sometimes when you request morphine, the morphine injection, you know, they can be very, they will question you as to why you need it because you just had it an hour ago. And I've heard some pretty awful stories about people, certain people getting accused, coming in to hospital too frequently, being admitted too frequently because the doctors and nurses believe that they are addicted to morphine and painkillers. And I really strongly believe that this is a stigma that we have to banish within the sickle cell community, because if you're not a sickler, you have no idea how painful a sickle cell crisis is, and you have no idea how frequent you can be admitted into hospital. I've been in situations where I've been discharged by a doctor on one day and been admitted into hospital 12 hours later. There is no there is no set timings as to when you can get sick and when you can't get sick. It can be as frequent as possible. So I think it's very unfair that some sicklers get judged on the frequency that they get admitted, and just because they're requesting for pain relief, and it's something that we need to stamp out in the sickle cell community.
And then there are groups of people who have heard of sickle cell, who may have friends that have sickle cell or know of somebody through somebody who's got sickle cell, but they don't understand the implications of the condition. And those are the people you hear say things like, oh, it doesn't matter, it's not that deep, oh, it's not too much of an issue if me and my partner both have sickle cell trait. It's only a 25% chance that the child will have sickle cell anemia. It's a 25% chance for each pregnancy. And I think sometimes that's also misunderstood or misconstrued. People think that it's just one in four. So if I don't have four children, then I won't end up with one with sickle. That's not how it works at all. It's a 25% chance for every pregnancy.
As in, you know, this just stems to lack of awareness. You know, if it's a trained medical condition trying to tell me about a condition that he doesn't know much about, how much confidence can I have in the medical profession? So this awareness stems in like different areas of society, you know, doctors, nurses, you know, family members, you know, the whole general public. It's like we need more awareness for sickle cell, and the only way that we can get that out there is by people being confident enough to speak about sickle cell so that we can break the stigma, because there is a lot of stigma. I've been faced with so many situations where I've spoken about my sickle cell in my places of work, and it was like a situation where I had to go above and beyond to prove how my condition limits me in certain areas. But it wasn't a thing where, you know what, we found out that he's got sickle cell, let's try and adapt ourselves to him working in the environment. It was like, no, you've got to prove that it affects you in this way. You've got to give us this, you've got to give us that. I'm not thinking, you know, all it takes is for me to tell you about sickle cell and for you to actually research, because I'm your employee.
I think the best way to raise awareness and visibility is through media, television, social media, things like that. And I feel like it's very important for the younger generation to be aware of sickle cell and how it can impact their lives or a potential loved one's lives. And I think it's so many people are still not aware that they could potentially be carriers. I think a lot of people just shrug it off and think, no, that's not me, I don't have that. But you would never know unless you got tested. So I think it is, the education does need to be stepped up and improved in the UK.
Awareness, awareness, awareness. The more awareness that we have about sickle cell, the more people are informed, and the more funding that we can get to medical treatment, care, and hopefully a global cure, not just for the Western world, but the whole of Africa, Caribbean, and third world countries.
I think more needs to be done within our communities to kind of educate people on sickle cell, because the problem is people will only learn if they encounter something. If something is hidden, you're not going to learn. So I also would like to ask other sickle patients who may be hiding the fact that they've got sickle cell, or maybe are not as vocal about it, to be vocal, speak up. Because the only way we're going to get change and funding in our community for treatment is if we are vocal. That's the only way we're going to make a change.